saw the last one that is love. Never thought you could make for a new start. Never thought you could listen to your heart. Your heart and I may don't try to tell me that I'm wrong. That I'm wrong. Your heart and I may don't try to tell me that I'm wrong. That I'm wrong.
The House of Love, everybody knows any minute now they're putting out their first LP as like a major band and, you know, all the fuss that that entails. So we thought we'd take the opportunity before everyone starts being horrible to them to look back and see how well they've done so far.
I think we've been fortunate in the way that we've been dealt with by the press. I mean, they've been really supportive, and sooner or later, I should think they'll get fed up of what they've said, or a different group of journalists will decide that, you know, the time has come to try and dethrone us or whatever. But press is such an important part of the development of a group commercially. It's vital, yeah. So obviously we've been well pleased with that. Generally speaking, it's for us recently, it's just been coming to terms with the project that we didn't even realise existed. I mean, you know, halfway through our European tour, we thought, you know, God, is this it? You know, I mean, do we want to spend the rest of our lives or the next 10 years doing this? You know, because it really got on top of us. And then at the end of it, we just thought we'd cope with it. We know how we're going to be dealing with it next year. Don't feel quite the same way. I mean, the thing is that because it's such an emotional level on which you operate, you know, touring especially, you change from one week to the next. You know, one week you want to give it up. The next week it's just the best thing that's ever happened in your life. What we do is very logical. We're a good rock band, and we're tuneful, and we have interest. We have an interesting approach, and you know, we have our own sound. It's quite simple, really. And rock music, when it's done in a reasonably original way, it always works. And you know, we've been going 2 years, and you know, we were resisted a long time. And last year, we thought. You know, we were exactly the same last year as we are this year, and we couldn't understand. You know, we thought, well, what we're doing is good. You know, what is the problem? I mean, we make good records, we have good things written about our records, but it didn't happen. You know, so I don't think there's anything. The thing is, when people pick up, when the press particularly pick up on something, they decide they like it, they decide it should be, they just go for it, hook, line, and sinker. It's the same every country in Europe. They write in exactly the same way. You know, they look for icons all the time. They're always trying to justify the term youth culture. They're always trying to alienate and restate. And so it's, you know, we're just part of the process. The House of Love is very much an attitude, and we're very aware of it, and we've become more aware of it recently. And we'll know when it's time to stop, but I mean, we don't sort of... we're very excited about, you know, how our sixth album will sound. I mean, you know, genuinely, I mean, it's something that... it's exciting, you know, it's... We feel, actually, that we have no restrictions musically, and that, it'll just be a question of maybe one of us will crack up or something like that. Maybe something like that will happen, but otherwise, I don't think there's any problem at all. And we're really excited about, you know, being together in a long time. We're good.
After Pere Ubu split a few years ago, David Thomas went on to work with the Wooden Birds. However, Pere Ubu are now back together again, so I asked David Thomas why they reformed.
Pere Ubu, number one, Pere Ubu, we simply ran out of ideas and got fed up, so we stopped. We didn't really break up. It was very... Pere Ubu's first part of our career was just like one of those Jack Kerouac on the road movies where you're in this beat-up old sedan driving across country with your foot to the floor all the time, and you're running up on intersections and you're saying, go this way, and you go this way, and then go this way, and then finally you roll up on the beach out in Santa Monica, and the flaps are flipping this way and that on the car, and the steam is coming out and the hood's bounced up and doors are dropping off, and it's like one of these Keystone comedy things, and everybody walks away from it. During the course of the ensuing time, we would more and more of us began to work together during the solo period. And so finally, you know, we realized one day sitting around in a hotel room in Holland that this was Pere Ubu, and that, you know, it walked like a duck and it quacked like a duck and it looked like a duck and it was therefore a duck, you know. So it really just came back together again organically, and it was Pere Ubu, so we had to call it Pere Ubu, because there's a history, there's a language, there's a grammar, of sound, and a tradition that's very rich and should be not allowed to go to waste, you know.
How much do you think that your goals and, in a way, aspirations have changed since you first started, say, in 75?
Not a bit.
You've not become more materialistic at all as time's gone. Oh, people do, though. Besides, people
look forward
to
the day
it.
That I could afford to buy the top of the line Roberts radio, but beyond that, no. I mean, well, the point has always been, I mean, we were very fortunate in that there was absolutely no hope that we would ever have a record contract or be successful, so we simply made music to entertain ourselves. We always compared what we did to the pioneers out on the plains when they would get together out in, you know, with five people in the middle of 100 square miles and do music for their own entertainment. This is why we say that music should be personal, music should be provincial, music should have an accent.
Do you think you deserve respect?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think we've created a body of work that certainly is almost unparalleled, and it's uncompromising and willful disdain for common sense in the business world, you know. And I think that certainly we deserve respect. We've created a body of work that's very, very outstanding, you know. And it's very pleasurable that people, you know, cite us as great influences and cite us as, you know, they're as it were heroes and things musically.
Do you think that you've improved with age, or do you ever look back on your past career with pride and embarrassed about what you're doing now, or is it vice versa?
I'm as happy with Pere Ubu in the beginning as I am now. I mean, we've done things, you do things that you think afterwards, oh, why did we do that? That's stupid. But generally, no. I mean, the point of Pere Ubu and the point of our career was to establish a language of, and to be able to develop things over a period of time, and to see, just very quickly, I don't care if you don't have any time, you ask me these questions, I'm answering them. You see, you look at that, you say, that's a cup. I'll buy that cup. I recognize that cup. But this cup is also this, and it's that, and it's looking at it this way and that way, and the all sorts of ways of looking at it. Now, you wouldn't buy that. You wouldn't go to, they wouldn't advertise it like a cup like this in a store and say, buy this, because you'd say, what's that? And you'd say, oh yeah, that's a cup. I don't want to buy that. No. But that's the cup, too. All of this is the cup. So you have to see it from all different angles. You know, one album we do is going to be like this, and you're saying, well, I'm not going to buy that. That's not a cup. I don't know what that is. That's the cup. This is the cup. That's the cup. That's the cup. So we set out to do a career in which you would look at something like this. You would look at Pere Ubu like this. You would look at what we're talking about like this, and you would know what a cup was. If you only know a cup this way, you don't know the cup. Thank you, Andy. Good night.
This here is the Thekla, also known as the Old Profanity Showboat, which is a place, like, if you're around Bristol and you're not actually in jail or dead, you've probably been in once or twice. They have all kinds of stuff goes on in here. They have theatre, they have groups, they have discos. It's a mental place, and so if you're in Bristol, you should go and see it. Better than the zoo, anyway. Here's the featured album.
1, 2, 1, 2. Groove those feet, we're nearly there.
10 more miles and we don't care.
Feeling great and that's no lie.
I'm so hungry I could die.
Let's get back to my mate.
Who's mate?
Your mate.
My mate.
My mate.
My mate.
What's up?
What's up?
Feed me.
Feed me.
Good stuff.
Good stuff.
My mate.
My mate.
Now you've discovered Gloria Estefan.
1, 2, 3, 4, come on, baby, say goodnight, baby.
Get her new album, Anything For You.
Rhythm is gonna get you, rhythm is gonna get you.
From exciting dance tracks to romantic ballads.
Anything for you.
The album includes all her latest hits.
But I can't stay away from you.
Anything For You, the wonderful album from Gloria Estefan.
Sweet, the remarkable sweetening ingredient that brings the sweet taste you love to all kinds of good things, with only a fraction of the calories. Look for the NutraSweet label on your favorite products. NutraSweet, the taste the world is turning to.
Mind you, I need a racing start if I'm to get it clean by 10. Flash liquid.
Ready for your driving lesson, Mrs. Jones.
Flash liquid. Formula One for floors.
We'll be right back.
Behind me over here, beautiful Church of St. Mary Redcliffe. Behind me over here, one of the finest bus shelters in Western Europe. Over there, Rachel with the new releases.
But still worth mentioning is the In Spiral Carpets Train Surfing EP, which has been out on Cow Records for a couple of weeks now, and the Waltones album Deepest on Medium Cool Records, which is finally in the shops. Also on Medium Cool is Landslide by the Pop Guns, and the Groove Farm released their Haters and We'll Love You to Death EP. The Great Leap Forward release an album called Don't Be Afraid of Change on Communications Unique. The Senseless Things release a double A-side single on Way Cool Records called Girlfriend and Standing in the Rain. And the House of Love's debut major release called Never is out now. And hopefully we'll have the video on next week's show. Finally, Danielle Dax is back with this one on Awesome Records called White Knuckle Ride. Hugo Largo want their audience to feel they've been hit by the softest baseball bat in the world. So I spoke to Tim and Harm from the band to find out exactly what they meant.
Yeah, I'll stand by that. I think what I meant by that was that you can make rock music that's quiet music. I think for years and years the association has been that if you make quiet music, it either has to be folk music or it has to be new age music. But you can do delicate things and you can do things that aren't necessarily at the highest volume, but still at a pretty high level of energy, or it's still a pretty high level of emotional intensity, but you don't necessarily, it doesn't have to be new age music, it doesn't have to be folk music. And I think that's something that's been happening in the late 1980s and is gonna really spread in the 1990s, is a whole sort of movement of people making quiet rock and roll, quiet rock music. I think that the Cowboy Junkies are a good example of that, you know, and there are gonna be plenty of others as well. Hardiness sometimes implies forcing something. That's the bad side of hardiness. and we're not that. We don't force what we do. I think it comes pretty naturally to us. We have never been intentionally weird or intentionally, even intentionally unique. I think we do things differently, but the things we do come pretty easily to us, and that's what I think makes us different, makes us say, and I've been told this by people who've come to see us, that's what makes us artistic, but not arty, and what makes us different or unique, but not weird. Because deliberate weirdness or deliberate artiness, I think, is like a really bad thing to be. And, you know, it's to really be avoided. And if you can do something different and put the pieces together a little differently without saying, gee, what can I do now to be so unique? What can I do now to be different and weird? I think you've really achieved something.
We get very extreme reactions from people, meaning people love us and they hate us, which is fine. I mean, I always thought that was an admirable quality in a group, to be able to elicit such strong reactions. It's definitely not for everybody. I don't think we have illusions about being a massively popular group.
That reminds me to invite you into a deep well, hollering from inside a deep well, 'cause I was somewhere else, thinking someone else is lost, and not hollering.
We didn't. If we wanted to make money, we'd be doing something else, you know.
That's certainly true.
I was in a bookstore yesterday, and I saw these little digests. It was a pretty conventional bookstore, but it had in the sort of magazine section, the sort of little fanzine, devoted only to Hawkwind, and I thought, well, that's great, you know. That's kind of like the sort of thing I'd like us to sort of be, sort of like, you know, that we'd be this band who meant a great deal to a few people. I think I anticipate that we're going to end up in the tradition of bands, you know, like Velvet Underground or Wire or Pere Ubu.
Bootsy Collins.
Bands who attract, say, far more interest 5, 8, 10, 15 years after the release of their records than they did possibly at the time of their release.
So we're erecting a huge monument in our...
It's a bit of a weird concept, though, sort of like thinking, what we're doing now is being ignored, but like 5-10 years' time, we're going to be mega.
It's difficult explaining it to the phone company when they call on you to pay the bill. Hold off 15 years. I think that's when the royalties are going to start coming in. But it's like, I know that the Velvet Underground were less popular in the States, for instance. I can't speak for England. I suppose England as well. Were less popular, far less popular, during their own time than we are now. And we're not very popular at all. But yet, those records did not sound anything like records where people were making in 1967, 68, and 69. Much the same way as I hope that our records don't sound like anything that was made in 1987 and 1988 and 1989. And I think that is a quality that's going to stand out perhaps more in the future when people look back and say, there wasn't another band at the time like Hugo Largo.
So, and, you know, they should listen to that and buy our records in the used bins now before they become, you know, very expensive items.
'Cause I was somewhere else, thinking someone else is lost, and not hollering from inside a deep.
Rachel talking to Hugo Largo there. After the break, we'll be talking to some more people.